Name another podcast like this.
Check it, check it, check it. It's a unique host. It's your boy, ECO, and I'm here with the lovely, amazing official, Miss Jamaica. What's going on?
Not you know my day, I walk on.
Man, hold up, man. Man, I've been up and done it, man. Hey, man, we got a special guest in here today, man. You know, I suppose, you know, I'm going to get this right, man.
Let's try it. Let's just give it, you know.
Cynthia.
Give it a shot. You said it right.
Bam. Yeah. Cynthia Luciette. I've been looking at this name for a minute now. You know, I'm kind of slow. Today is a takeoff day, though. I'm moving up. Y'all got to respect it, man. Cynthia Luciette is in the building.
Yeah. Do you mess up people's names a lot?
Never. It's just yours. You know what I'm saying? Like, dang. I don't know. It's just something about it. You know, I said, damn, you know, I'm going to mess this up. And in your mind, when you tell yourself something, it might happen that way. So you are a comedian.
Yeah. I do a lot of things. I'm a comedian. I'm a TV host, a writer, a creator.
You're a TV host of what?
Yeah. Recently, TMZ Hip Hop on
Fox. Hey, I seen that. I didn't want to believe it. I want you to say it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I was like, you know, I don't mind informing people. Yeah.
So how did you get into that?
Man, it was so crazy because one of the co-hosts who was on there, like, he kind of got the position first. And then they were like, oh, like, what women can you see on here? And he recommended me and they checked out my stuff. And it happened so fast, like, because they were on a tight deadline. So they flew me out there, auditioned. Before I even got back on the plane to come back to Dallas, they was like, yeah, we'd love to have you. I was like, for sure. And then 3 weeks later, I was out there for like 3 months filming it. It was fun.
You know, that's a
how long
you
been? How long ago was that?
Go ahead.
That was April to June. So that was
okay, just
yeah.
Recently. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go back.
So I'd like to know where you're from, how you were raised, all of that good juice.
Okay, so I'm from Rochester, New York. It's like, you know, not fully upstate New York. It's mm-hmm. kind of like in the middle by Syracuse or Buffalo. And yeah, I like to say like people like to act like it's a suburb. I'm like, no, like it was the face.
They got a hell of a twang up in Manhattan, but you don't have that same sound.
No.
So this is a totally different situation now.
Yeah.
It's cold as hell up there anyway you look at it, though.
It is. It definitely snows more in Rochester. What about it?
I'm saying it's cold up there, but you looking over there.
It is. What is New York getting over there like?
Go ahead. Let's get back to it.
Yeah, so then after that, you know, around like 1920, I went out to L.A. And then I did a whole bunch of shit out there. And
so you were raised with your mom and dad?
Yeah, they still together.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Brothers, sisters?
I got 4 siblings. It was 5 total.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So brothers and sisters.
Yeah, and I have 3 brothers, 1 sister.
Okay, so mm-hmm. Only one that is like the comedic side, or did you get it from your mama, your daddy, your grandparents?
I definitely got it from my mom. You know, my mom's really smart, and so like she has a degree, a master's degree in psychology, so like she could just read people really well. So like without even trying to be funny, she just says like a lot of things about people that's really real. So yeah, I feel like I get that from her, but.
Baby, is this the night when we went down to see Bubba Dub? She was there. Was she there that night?
I don't think she was the one on stage.
Because there was one on that stage that night. I know it wasn't her. Because, boy, if it was, we better have a hell of a situation here. But keep going. it was a hell of a night that night. But we ain't going to get into it. Listen, I'm saying, was she one? It was 3 girls, wasn't it? About 3 of them?
Oh, no. That wasn't me then.
Oh, well, I'm just hoping like hell it wasn't. But at any rate, because it's not going to be good. You know, I can't lie. Sometimes, you know, the truth comes out here because I'm a godly man.
What is the truth?
Well, I ain't going to go there because they ain't
go
here to defend.
This is boss talk 101. Hey, listen, though.
But if they was here to defend themselves, boy, I'd have lived. I was wishing that was you.
Well, it might be her.
You don't got to name names.
It wasn't. No, I like the name names.
Oh.
But you don't even remember the name.
Names.
You don't even remember the name.
Oh, yeah. But I remember the swag, and I knew that wasn't you because you too sophisticated, really. You got a little more sophistication than she had. You know what I'm saying? She would not get off the stage, though. Hell no.
Oh, no.
It was all night. They were flashing the lights. I was in that all confused, but having a great time. You remember that?
No.
I was tripping on that.
Think about me.
She wouldn't get off.
I'll be like, I'm done. Like, yeah, I have no problem doing that.
We went up there four times. They were flashing. I didn't know all the signals y'all had. They were flashing lights. They had lights from the booth coming. They had the man come up. He stood by the stage. It was all kind of, I said, damn, I did not know they do this. And yeah, she was steadily going in. I said, this can't be her. She done brought her ass up.
I did that one time. I did that one time, and like my big brother in comedy was there, and he was like, did you not see the light? I was like, what you mean? Like, I told you, he was like, no.
You
like,
didn't know.
And so after that, I was just like, I'm very aware of time. But you know, I have to go up after people sometimes who do that, you know, especially when you're
and you have to cut your time short if they took too much time.
That happened to me recently. Yeah, like somebody was going longer than they
were.
Was
you upset?
I'd have been mad.
No.
You like, I'm gonna get my money anyway.
Yeah, I'm like, I'm that's just I'm fine right, I'm gonna go do my, you know.
He's and a night,
I I kept it short and tight. It was like, it's less work. Like, you know, that's like if you got a day, like, okay, do an 8-hour shift, but now just do 2 hours, but we're going to pay you the same. Like,
man.
But it's different. To me, when you love what you do and you planned out, okay, this is my skit, this is what I'm going to say, and this is going to be funny, and I already thought about it. They gonna crack up, they gonna this, they gonna that, and then you go up there and you know, you can't say everything you wanna say.
Yeah, but sometimes after you go up after certain people and then it is long and then they started the show late and it's like I do other things, you know. I don't have to, this is not the last show ever. So it's like
she gonna walk out.
Cause it depends, you know. It depends. When it's a show, when it's a lot of people on there, you just gotta take it. Like, there's so many people. If you let that bother you, it's like, but then there's certain shows where it's like, nope, just a lineup is a tight show. Everybody does their everything, and you work together all weekend.
So I got a question. So going back to TMZ, so you know, we all been watching TMZ, know what TMZ is all about.
Right.
So when you finally got there and did your thing, what were you thinking that it would be like compared to when you actually got there? You know, what's the difference?
Man, like, I would say I expected it to be like, I don't know. I wouldn't say harder, because it was definitely challenging having to wake up every day early as hell. But
what time you gotta wake up?
We shot pretty early, so I had to get up at like 4:30 a.m. Get to set by 5:30. We doing makeup till like 6:30. Get on set by 6:45. Like, so it was early, and it was
takes
daily,
an hour
so
to do the makeup
every day. Yeah, well, because there's other people on the cast too, so you're waiting for your spot, whatever.
How many females?
It was one other one, Amber Diamond. She was on Wildin' Out too.
Yeah.
It was super dope, but yeah, like I feel like they were just super chill. Like, I don't know, everybody was just really normal. A lot of people who were on the TV show were also writing and doing other things in the office, so it was like. But also, too, I was amazed at how much information comes in. Like, we were able to hear about stories with celebrities and stuff before it hit the internet, because they really do break so many news stories. So it'd be crazy in the morning getting brief of what's going on. It's like, yeah, this is about to get posted in like 30 minutes, but this is what's happening, da 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 da. And I'm like, dang, the world doesn't even know yet. Like, that's crazy. So that was what was amazing to me. It was like, damn.
Because they have their own investigators and everything like that. That's how they get all this news beforehand. Or do people just send the information in because they're TMZ?
Yeah, it's both ways. It's like everybody in the industry knows somebody. People are people's assistants. People are people's gardeners. You know, somebody's friends with somebody who's Kylie Jenner's makeup artist. Like, it's just, and people love to talk and gossip about people. Like, you know, they really get excited to be like, yo, guess what I saw this person doing. So it's kind of, they kind of snitch, you know.
Wow.
Yeah.
No, because I know that every time when I watch TMZ, I be like, seem like y'all have like a lot of fun, because they'll be just laughing and having a good time. Like, like y'all don't even notice the cameras, or y'all don't notice anything.
Yeah, they film really fast too. That's what I like about it, because sometimes with TV shows, you have to do so many takes of it, and it's like it could take all day.
How many takes y'all do?
None. Like, it's just
that one time.
Yeah, they'll be like, all right, y'all talk about this one topic for 6 minutes. All right, next story. Okay, boom, 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 boom. Like, we'll film the show within like 45 minutes to an hour. They'll get it done, get it edited. Because
it's not live, is it?
It's not live, no. They do have a live show, though, too. Mm-hmm. But no, this one was the hip hop show.
So they don't have to like hit out no bloopers or nothing like that. The bloopers stay in
there.
No,
they edit it, you know, but they just move really fast and get it. That's what I like, too, because I'm like, that reminds me more of the digital age. Like, you know, just going with it and getting it done.
How does it feel to be one of two females in where there's so many males in that industry?
I think it's cool because we work really well together. Like, we know how to have, like, different point of views. And, you know, me and her, we always laughed about it because we was the only two that, like, actually smoked weed on the show. You know, the guys, none of the guys smoke. So, like, after the show, we would be like, all right, cool, let's go smoke, let's go chill. We'd be like, damn, it's funny, only the girls smoke on the show. So, it's like, that was my buddy. So, you know, we knew how to play off each other really well.
So, okay, so getting back to your comedy, when did you first start your comedy? Like, how old were you?
I would say I really started doing it probably like 25. So, you like 4 or 5 years ago.
Why?
Because, you know what? I was doing sketches online. So, I was writing sketches and, you know, I was hosting different daily shows. But it was like with other comedians. So, I was like, you know, I was still making people laugh. Mm-hmm. So, I was like fulfilling that need, but in a different way.
You was doing sketches.
Yeah.
But explain to me what that
not
is.
You hopping back in. So
you doing sketches?
Yeah.
Well, talk to me about these sketches.
You know,
skits?
Skits, sketches.
What y'all were doing?
Mini movie clips.
And what was y'all, who was you with?
I was with a lot of different comedians. A lot of people from All Def. I don't know if y'all watch like All Def Digital Online.
What y'all was cutting up?
Yeah, we got some funny shit on there. Like, you know, a lot of it went viral. That's what a lot of people know me for.
I interviewed Alex Thomas. I said all that to say this. Mm-hmm. I interviewed Alex Thomas, and he was like, you know, being funny for 5 minutes is definitely in comparison. It does not compare to having to stand on that stage,
right,
and do a whole set.
Yeah.
So he you know, that funny that you guys are doing. Sometimes rubs the older comedians in the wrong way. Mm-hmm. So I've had a bunch of dilemmas on here about this. Now I want you to answer this question correct, because you're the first lady to answer this question. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
When it comes down to the old comedy, I'm talking about Martin Lawrence.
It's not just that old like that just started.
Martin Lawrence, Eddie Murphy, on right. You know, on the TV doing their thing, doing their residual thing, Faison Love, all of these cats versus the new, which is the Country Wayne and all of these other guys, the Desi Banks, the Bubba Dubs, the okay, these are two different worlds in comparison to one another. Which one do you think, you know, bringing in that cheddar is the better way to go in this day and time?
Definitely.
Wait a minute. Don't answer this wrong.
Listen, I'm not worried about nobody. But no, I mean, the thing is like, calling them old is kind of like, dang, the old versus
I'm
the
old. Hell, they old as me. Like, them niggas old. What?
Okay, being old, and then it's like, okay, like, they've accomplished so much, so then it's they had to trailblaze a lot, you know? But some of them can kind of still, let me think of who still is older to go viral. Ooh,
what you mean? Dave Chappelle, shut all you young niggas down, but I'm not talking about that. I'm just saying, you know, they ain't old. They dye their hair, but they still great. Don't let them fool you. I'm just a real cat around this old. But I know them niggas great. I don't have to see it. I know they grow. They shave and all their hair.
I would say like the people who are like, you know, the Desi Banks and even, you know, everybody who's from that same type of generation that we're from, it's like by the time you are Dave Chappelle's age, hopefully you will have accomplished somewhat. You know what I mean? You're going to be in a different category, but we have more access to get more popularity and more opportunities now. We do.
I get it. You can say that, but these people
it's like the digital platforms is a cheat code to get a lot of
it's
success.
It's not really a cheat code.
Not everybody who's funny online even wants to do stand-up, though.
But,
and that's the thing. A lot of stand-up comedians who are older, as you say, they do try to gatekeep, you know.
But the cheat code you're talking about is welcoming. Not really a cheat code. They not.
It is. Not yes, really. It is. Yes, when it you, is.
Okay,
what are you talking about?
Well, when Faison them over here, they talk about
people
the... Residuals. When you look at older people, the Will Ferrells, all these old comedians, they getting checks from old chicks.
Right. So you talking about from TV shows that they
all
made?
The stuff that they did. If it's
but not
old,
from stand up.
Even if it's stand up and it's one that they went on HBO or something, they still get residuals.
Okay.
Now don't try to educate. I'm old.
But,
I know about
this.
But
the thing is, though, I mean, Wild'n Out has residuals, so a lot of these
That's
comedians
my boy,
are,
Karlous. He was on there.
Yeah, so, you know, they have very good residuals.
Well,
you know,
I don't know about that. I heard a difference. See, now you're talking in my lane again. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. They do get residuals. But I mean, you know, they're gonna have time to accomplish that and earn the residuals. But when I say it's a cheat code, I mean like people who have a digital following do stand up for a year, and then I see them headlining theaters with, you know, 10,000 people in, and the people opening for them are some really well-trained, you know, veteran comedians, but they're opening up for, I won't name names, but they're opening up for digital, you know, people who've been doing stand-up for 320 days. And now you're headlining, and it's like, damn. And a lot of times, you know, but then you keep doing it, you're going to get better. You're going to get better.
You're going to get better, but you're still not going to be like the way it was. Because the way it was, when they would build, they would go, they would start doing movies, and then they would do stand-up. They have a whole HBO special, and it was just a different time. But they was building them up in a way to where it gave them generational wealth. Okay, mm-hmm. But on the side of the internet, hey, I'm digital. They basically give it, you do it, and you, when you do it, basically you done it, and it's there. But that's it. There's no contractual agreement. And the other day, I thought they were going to shut the YouTube down. They scared the hell out of me. So let me tell you something, baby. You don't really have a lot of leeway like that.
But once
that.
You start to grow, then you know somebody who actually works
with
YouTube.
They're going to shut the damn Instagram
down. You have a YouTube representative. You have an Instagram representative. You have people that you can directly call and contact to. It's like, it's a cheat code. So I feel like anybody, even if you're an older comedian.
What you think?
Shouldn't they even try to do stuff that's on the digital?
No, they should. I've always said that they should just combine both. If you've been doing, y'all been saying older comedian, newer comedian. So if the older comedian been doing their thing, earning their money, you know, like why not branch off, learn the newer wave, mm-hmm. and combine both? You'll earn even more money, you know, and then still show the newer wave comedians how to earn my money too, and mm-hmm. both of y'all just make a big bag and be done with it.
And I encourage even all of the people who've been doing stand up, you know, for years. I always encourage them, like, do more digital stuff, post rants, post your stand up clips, hop in, do, you know, different sketches. Because I think they're funny.
I encourage Faison Love of this the other day. Me and him was on the phone. We've been encouraging for the longest. Mm-hmm. He put me on the phone with Sags. He told me I got residuals. Them niggas ain't making no money. That nigga sent me pictures of houses and cars and told me y'all book whatever. So don't play me. Like, these niggas, when you talk to these niggas like I do, straight up, they gonna tell you, nigga, please.
Right.
Well, I don't care about that. What about my house in LA? What about my house in Florida? What about this? Nigga, I don't wanna do nothing on no internet with you. I'm just being real. That's where they're at with
but
it.
Then,
I'm
But I seen them do interviews with, like, different online people, like, I think Vlad TV.
Yeah, he doing Vlad, me, and a couple more. But still, I'm just saying, he's not that guy that's trying to do the stand up and act every day and run it because you don't have to. But I'm just saying,
wait 10 years because digital only going to get bigger.
What do you mean wait 10 years? Ten years, none of residuals going to get
coming. Shut down. You know what I mean?
You better hope like Instagram and YouTube
not
don't shut down.
Because now you got me wishing things like, you know, just a proof of point. Like, well, let's bet. You know
this question. Let me tell you something. This question has been one that I have messed with people about ever since. Faison come in here and then after that Mike Bliss came in here and then after that we talked to Karlous, but that was later on. Alex Thomas, Columbus Short. It's been a back and forth thing. So I just put you in the mix to something. That's all I did. I told you that alley oop, you got to slam that thing. But it does. It's a good question because those two worlds need to meet, especially if they're having differences and they don't agree.
Now, listen, it's way better than it was like 3-4 years ago. It was really a time when stand-up comedians did not like digital people trying to do stand-up, and I would feel the hate, and people, if you was close to me, I'd be like, y'all feel like you hating, like, you know, like, I just feel like you hating on people because you know that if they put their face on this, they can sell tickets because they got an audience. People are like, oh, I want to see Ha Ha Davis, you know. It's like, oh, I follow him online, he makes me laugh, I want to see him. Like, it's not even just about stand-up, but I think, you know, stand-up has to grow and evolve, just how hip-hop had to. Like,
oh, so stand-up needs to grow and evolve.
It's going to.
Okay.
It is.
Okay, I'm just listening because a lot
of
people.
The tickets are going to end up showing.
I ain't say it, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, I get it. Because this is a new world order. Is that what you call it?
I'm not trying to be the leader of this movement, you know, because I respect all the comedians.
No, I shouldn't even be over here. Like, I be messing with people too much, right? Damn, I love this, man. They gonna know you in a minute, though, because they know how you feel now about it. So they ain't like, that's so good to say that on Boss Talk. She was like, that's okay. I'm in my dress room. Stay in yours.
I mean, I've been vocal about it.
So you really, you're dope to be able to even understand how to live in both worlds, you know? How hard was it when you first got, did I miss that part? Did you talk about how hard it was when you first got on the stage already?
The hardest part was having like somewhat of a following online, or like, especially in the comedy world, a lot of people watch the comedy sketches I did on Deaf. So when I walk in, they're like, yo, I see you on your, yo, you mad funny. And I'm like, dang, like this is my third time on stage. So I gotta like, you have an expectation of me being this level. And I'm like, so I didn't get to practice in silence like a lot of comedians get to for a few years. I, from the very beginning, was like, people being like, oh, I've seen you before. Oh, I da-da-da. Especially other comedians or people who know comedy. So I'm just
Karlous Miller said something that was so live and so dope. He said, why would you, being that you a person that do, you know, internet-based stuff, whether it be skits or whatever, why would you come into this world and to the people who know you like they know you and change it and try to do something else other than what you do? And I thought that was so dope, because he said he would come in, take a selfie, do the stuff he do with that crowd, because that crowd is coming to see him and be himself.
If you want to do that, if that's what they come to
see, you know what I mean?
If you want to do improv, I think, you know, it would be fun for me too to do some improv shows and stuff like that. But that kind of goes tie into like doing what you do on Wildin' Out. But like, no, I want to do stand up. Like, some people who are digital creators actually want to do stand up, grew up watching stand up and they want to do that. So it's like, no, I'm not gonna just do that. And just, the world can know me for one thing, playing a crazy girlfriend in a sketch, but I have a million things I could talk about, and I'm not about to just be online doing sketches. So I don't agree. Like,
damn,
no.
I like that she went a different way with it. She wants to be, Faison would like her because she wants to really get on with what he does, and that's stand up. Who did you see early on that made you feel this way about stand up?
You know who really did? Katt Williams.
That nigga a fool right there. Did you see him fighting a little 15-year-old boy? Don't play with me. Nigga, don't try to play. I bring it all up on here.
I was talking about the first spark. It was such a beautiful moment I was about to describe to it. You like,
I bring it all the way in.
Remember, he was in Philly. He jumped at the meeting single concert like this.
So what did you like about him?
I would say like Pimp Chronicles. It was just like the time it came out and the age I was. It was like one of the first specials I watched and I understood. And I just like, for the first time, it was like, oh, comedy is a thing and certain people can do it. Because it was just, I don't know, it just clicked in my mind of like, stand-up comedy, people can take a thought and turn it into a whole joke. And it's like, things that I never thought before, he's making me laugh at. Like, it was just like, something just went off in my head, like, oh, comedy. Like, people do this. This is a gift. This is a real thing that, like, you do. But the more I watch him and I see him, the more I'm like, oh, he's still calculated with it. Now knowing how people do jokes and do stuff. But back then, it just looked like magic. It looked like a magic trick. And you're like, I want to be a magician, like, you know? But now I can see, like, oh, he set it up like this, and then he took it here. I could see the bone structure behind the jokes.
It's still
amazing to me. I still love it. But, like, yeah, Katt Williams was the first person. He's a Virgo, too.
He's a very competitive person. Big Court came on here and told about a basketball game that they played for a chopper. Yeah, and basically he lost, and then he tried to kill Big Court. What? So you think I'm making this up? You know what I'm saying? Big Court came down here from California. He flew in and he told me.
I just think he has a lot of energy. I think he's so good at comedy.
He came 80 miles per hour, 100 miles per hour, boom, and totaled his truck. I tried to kill my boy.
You gotta live your life. You gotta tell stories, you know? Like,
no, this is what happened. You can look back at it. This is real talk.
Did I say I didn't believe you? Like, I was like,
I couldn't believe it when he was telling me, like, what the hell? The nigga rear-ended him. Like, I'm going to play this clip in the midst of this. You know I am. He said the nigga rear-ended him and because he beat him in a game of basketball. Now, the guy is about 6'3", 6'2", and Katt is how tall? About 5'4"? 5'1"? 5'0"? 5 feet? So the nigga,
five feet,
the
not
nigga
five feet even.
The nigga playing a 6'3 nigga for a chopper. This made no sense to me.
Is he still cool with Katt?
No, they fell out.
Oh,
he got on the thing and tried to be cool to with him. At, the nigga tried to kill him. What
would you be cool with somebody who tried to do that to you?
No.
Okay.
No.
And then Big Court is Master P's best friend.
Right.
So this is some real.
He did a guest episode on TMZ Hip Hop.
Oh, so it makes sense now.
I know exactly what you're talking about. Big Court.
Big Court.
I know exactly what you're talking about. He was a guest host on TMZ Hip Hop. That's funny.
Yeah, him and Katt. It don't matter about that. He said Katt tried to kill him. That's funny.
That is not funny. It's not funny, but what's funny now is because I can picture who you're talking about, and I'm
playing
like,
basketball against him.
You tried to do that to him.
So this is the guy
Hulk?
That you brought him up. So
Hulk.
I wanted to try to figure out how to relate to Katt Williams. That's what I got.
Yeah. Well, at Pip Chronicles, I don't think that had happened yet. You know.
No, I think it's dope that you would find somebody that you like that. Somebody that you can relate to. Is it any other women that stick out to you? Because he got not long hair like a girl, but
right.
No. Who was this?
Women like what?
I like Monique.
You like Monique?
Like, what do you think
she's so
Monique?
that lead that and what was
no,
her name?
What do you think about Monique?
What I like about Monique is that, you know, she stood her ground. I like anybody who can stand their ground. I blocked somebody today. Well, no, I almost blocked him. I didn't actually block him, but I was just kind of like taking a step back because he had called me. He like, why you didn't answer the phone? I'm like, I just need some distance. I don't think this is healthy for us. And he's like,
he's a comedian too.
I'm not gonna get into that. And he's like,
no, you're not calling the name. You're just saying he's a comedian.
You know, he's in the world.
Come on, this is what I do. Bring it.
But listen, it's just, you know, it's something. It's a situation that I'm like, this is not. You know, when you just know a relationship can be so toxic. I feel like this is blocking my blessings. So I got to get rid of you.
Oh, okay, got you. Because
you and your baggage is gonna block.
Did that nigga put his hands on you?
No, I've been left at other person did that. But my thing is, this is what he said to me. He was like, you know what? You always go back and forth with me like this. If you say this, you need to stand on
aggressive.
It.
That's aggressive.
And I was like, you know what? I do have a problem standing on it. Like, sometimes I'll say something and I'll be like, I'll take it back. Like, you know. Yeah. So what I love about Monique, I said that to say, while I emotionally unloaded on y'all, felt good. I said that to say, Monique stands on it. You know, she feels something is something that I think she really has thought to that she feels and she stood on it all the way until Lee Daniels came back apologized and gave her another role. So I just gotta stand on it.
Exactly.
You know? But do you know how much hell she went through trying to stand on it with you niggas? But do you know how they treated her? I watched them demolish her character. Yeah, it was a bunch of them. It felt like to me that everybody was against her. She went on the Breakfast Club and she called, what's that boy's name? Charlemagne. What did she call his real name?
Leonard.
And she was hailing that nigga real well.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, when she
but
left.
But that's a classic
when
auntie.
Left,
like, well, I don't want to call her auntie. Some people be like, don't call me auntie.
Yeah. When she
like,
left, she felt like, and I felt it for her because I'm a fan. We paid to go see her a lot of time. When
I
every other nigga turned his back on her who he was there for. Yeah, we went to the show. Wasn't no
who
nobody
turned their back on her?
Y'all did. Your people did.
No.
Yeah, your people did it. Lee Daniels and them was hard on her.
But he don't represent everybody.
Yeah.
He was going through the whole thing with Empire and Jesse.
He represents
like,
a lot of people.
Stuff.
If he get mad at you and you do something kind of wrong, he can shut you down. He's with a group, elite group of people. They do not play.
Then why are you trying to play with them now?
But my girl, she held
up.
But
you
said.
You should be fucking with like.
But the girl still stood her ground. You
she
should
did.
Be. That's some heavy.
She
that's
did.
Heavy.
And Oprah. And Tyler Perry didn't, I think, three people.
Wait a minute. Say that again. I don't know.
I
didn't know you were that bold.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Yeah, her, Oprah.
And Tyler Perry. Yeah.
Like, she was, because they was working on a movie together.
So, Oprah and Tyler Perry did what?
I don't remember exactly what they did, but I think they didn't pay her. They wanted her to go on a press run, and they didn't pay her.
And she let them have
she was like,
it.
I'm not going to go. And then I think she said that people said she was hard to work with. And
I never seen that. And did you think she was like that? Because you never heard nothing like that before that happened between her and Lee Daniels.
I think I definitely stand on the side of like people don't think they have to pay women as much as they pay men. And then especially black women in Hollywood, like it's a known fact that they'll pay less because they just see less value. So it's like,
the only way they pay less.
But you hear that a lot, though, with
Oprah could have cut a check.
With the female industry, with the females, you always hear that, she's hard to work with. She's too much of a diva. You don't really hear that about men as much that, he's hard to work with. He's this. He think he's that. you hear mainly about the females.
Mm-hmm. And men be doing all this sexual assault on set and some other shit.
You're not for the set.
Now, that's what you're not going to do. That's what you're not going to do.
I've been waiting whatever. I'm going to tell the truth. A lot of time women jump up and put themselves in situations mentally that a man might not even be taking it there. Right. So a lot of times women are already scorned and bringing baggage into the whole damn place, talking about somebody looking at them. Nigga ain't even studying them. I had one here last night. Mm-hmm. It utterly amazed me what was said, because I seen what I seen. I'm like, why the hell would a nigga do that? So don't get on here talking about every man just because you think every man wants you.
I didn't say every man.
I'm just saying some women. Now, I didn't say every woman. Mm-hmm. But some women in their mind have this persona that every man is looking at them. When I can guarantee you, just because a man speak to you don't mean he wants you.
I mean, no.
Yeah, but it's a lot of them think that. I know they think that. Because I done had them on here, so I'm just going to be real with you. Ain't nobody looking at all y'all. Some of y'all.
It seems like you talking to somebody, I might have to cut this part out because if we put it out too fast, but she won't know.
But at the end of the day, if you think somebody looking at you, or if you think somebody wants you at every place you go,
I'm stepping for her. Sweetheart, I was here now.
You take a look in the mirror and make sure you look close.
Right, yeah.
Because mama lied to you. You know what I'm saying? Mama them done lied to you. You know what I'm saying?
Don't do that.
No, but it's a lot of them that it is a true case, too. So I understand that part.
No,
but
yeah,
for it gotta
sure.
be balanced, man, in your decision and your thinking. You can't think everybody wants you. If they do want you, they just want one thing a lot of times. Well, and then when they see it or get in the room with it, they might not even want it no more.
To physical touch, or by the time, you know, you say a certain things, like people get caught red-handed. They be wilding. Even politicians, mm-hmm. you know, like, get caught sending dick pics and stuff like that. You get caught with a screenshot trying to get an abortion, and you say you're anti-pro-choice, but you're
what about
Republican?
The woman that go get pregnant by somebody that you just met and jump in the bed with them and sending all type of, man, I need child support before she can even get the
accidents
damn pregnancy
happen.
No, I'm saying it's two sides to every story. I'm not gonna let y'all just bash
it's y'all not one size fit all. Babies aren't one size fit all. Nothing it's very few things.
Yeah, it's a lot of balancing going on. If a man did it, a woman could have did it. It's the same thing to me. They lie a little better than us too, and they hide it a little better. I'm gonna just say that. That's my personal opinion. I'm sticking to it. Boss Talk 101, where the bosses talk. You know what I'm saying?
I don't mind saying women do anything better. I'll take it. Yep, we lie better. Whatever. I'll take it all day.
I just say we all the same, man. I think a lot of times it's a tug of war.
No, women are better.
No, it's a tug of war. It's very much a tug of war because you want to be right. Yeah. And then, you know, I'm just sitting back here just listening a lot of times because I don't even want to argue with you. You know what I mean?
So, let me get in some. So where do you see the comedy, or where do you see yourself in the next year and a half?
I mean, I definitely want to do more stuff on TV. I got this show, this podcast on Defiant Digital. It's called Funny Advice. We had Karlous on that one. We've had a lot of different comedians on it.
How long ago did y'all start that?
We just filmed it in August, and then we released two episodes, and then we're about to do six more. We're about to drop six more. So, and then I'm going to chill for the year.
So y'all don't drop very often.
We're kind of like testing it out and getting the flow of it and seeing like what we wanted to do. And then getting fillers out to see where we could take it and stuff. But I didn't want to film a whole bunch of things because it's like I want to see it and then adjust and then make it better and then see what I could do.
Okay.
And that network too, they like really high quality. Like they all about like the quality.
Right.
So, you know.
So your main focus is your comedy.
Yeah, I mean, comedy and creating too. You know, I don't like doing just one thing because it's like you can get sick of it. So it's like having a little break here and there, being able to do other stuff is fun as well. You know, like with
your
like
attention span is short, isn't it?
Yeah, I can tell. I'm very hyperactive, so I like doing like multiple things at once for sure.
I can tell.
I thought I was here mad calm. I wasn't even too fidgety and shit. I thought I'm covering it up. Like, yeah, I'm a little hyperactive.
I like it.
You know, I can keep myself a little calmer now.
What's the name of your podcast again?
Funny Advice on Defiant Digital.
That's crazy. When you think about what do you want to gain from this podcast?
From this podcast, really, I just want to get more connected with Dallas, you know.
Well, you're in the right place.
I'm based out here now because my family moved out here, so I go back and forth from, like, here to L.A. and Atlanta, different places. But yeah, you know, I like Dallas. I want to grow out here. I want to build like my production company out here, start bringing more like the film stuff that I learned in LA and kind of just grow out here. How I seen like Tyler Perry and Oprah and shit and grow. Yeah. I think it's like you can have more space to grow. But Tyler, I really like Texas.
Who else you say?
Oprah in Chicago. And then Tyler Perry was out. He built his whole thing. He filmed everything.
I went down and looked at that massive thing. Yeah, that's massive.
It's huge. You know? So what's your top three comedians of all time that are alive?
Oh, that's so hard. I don't know. Top three.
Katt Williams, go on and say him because you already said him.
Definitely Katt Williams.
I can help you with this.
And then I would say Bernie Mac too because I definitely grew up watching the Bernie Mac show. And I really think more comedians should have like comedy sitcoms coming back like that based off of jokes.
They get residuals. Go ahead.
Yeah. And then I would just say Kevin Hart because it's like, you know, somebody who kind of has endorsed me in a lot of ways. And I think just the way he's a mogul is like, you know, that's kind of how like a lot of rappers looked up to people like a Diddy or, you know, whoever else, like a Jay-Z, how you became a mogul. I think at least me as a comedian, it's like that's a mogul.
Right.
And, you know,
he said he's endorsed you in many ways. Tell me one way he has endorsed you.
Well, just like, you know, when he started the Laugh Out Loud Network, gave me opportunities to, you know, work with them, film stuff, and then gave me different brand deals to like help promote, you know, his movies and stuff. Like he worked with just influencers and was like, oh, if I want to promote my movie instead of just paying for all billboards promotions, let me like pay. And he flew a whole bunch of influencers out to Hawaii had us out there for the whole day, and he was just there filming sketches with us, you know.
Oh, that's dope.
And that's like stuff like that is like, dang, not a lot of comedians who are, as you say, like the people who were before digital completely took off. Not a lot of them open the doors like that, and they're still kind of competitive with it. But he definitely made it clear to us, like, nah, I want to help. I want to build platforms that y'all can eat off of, too.
Yeah.
So that's lit to me. I want to do that.
I think you dope. I know you got that traction on digital, you know, the digital world.
We growing. You know, you're one of them
type people, you know. And it's good to see people that look like me just making moves on their own. Like, how do you like it, the direct-to-consumer approach that the internet has brought to everybody?
I love it. I think it's like, it's a way, you know, no matter, you can't control other networks and platforms and what they put on there, you know, this, it's like, if this is y'all's thing, this isn't gonna stop till you want it to stop. So that's what I love most about digital. Like, if I wanna stop something, I'm gonna stop it. If I wanna do something, I'm gonna do it. Like, you're in control of it. And that works very well for my brain.
Do you watch Country Wayne?
Yeah, I do.
What do you think about him?
I think he's funny. I think he got a lot of kids. I think
he got a lot of kids. Wait a minute. I said, I'm talking about the stuff y'all doing in the comedy world and digital world. You done brought that man kids up in
there. Well, he includes in a lot of his comedy.
How many kids do we got? Since you thought he got a lot of kids. That's what I thought.
I want to say 8, but I'm like, oh, it might be 6. Does anybody
your friend
know?
Hanging up. It's 8 or 9?
It's 9. 9.
Okay, what's the problem?
It's nothing, but
because
I'm just saying,
$430, like, $430,000 a month.
That's lit.
So what about it?
That's 8.
And Jesus is popping.
I'm just saying, like, that's somebody who could do a Bernie Mac type story. Like, that's an interesting storyline. You can't. That's just what I think of. It's a lot of kids.
Damn. My nigga, just that's all you could think of? All them damn video drip.
I said something else first before that. I know for sure that wasn't the first thing I said.
You said that's the case.
So hold on. So if that's the case, what's the first thing that comes on top of your mind when I say Nick Cannon? First thing that comes to top of your mind.
I would think businessman.
Yeah, but you think kids on my boy. They both got a lot of
well,
kids.
Well, I know. I don't know Country Wayne like that. I know Nick Cannon more.
That's
so
your boy, huh?
It's not my boy, what? But it's like he, you know, he was on Wildin' Out. He's the boss on Wildin' Out. He came and did an interview for the podcast I produced, Hot Tea. He came and did an interview on there. Super dope.
So that's like, why you show him favor and don't bring his kids up. Let's be real for a minute. That's the only thing say that new. You know what I'm saying? You'd have brought the new kids up here and did your show. Country Wayne, you might need to come do her show because she bringing up your kids on here, man.
Yeah, then I might be like, yeah, no, he's super, he's from here, he's from there, you know. Yeah,
no,
that's
dope,
a good point. That's a good point. I can't argue when it's a good point, you know?
No, I think it is. It does mean more to you when you link with people. I have linked with Country Wayne and Mike and Jordan Jackson, so I'm not going to sit on here and let you bring his kids up and not bring
Jesus.
That he brought up. Jesus is popping. And he Jesus also takes, he employed all his family.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know who, I mean, and I had a guy on here.
Wait a minute, like I said something bad.
I had a guy on here that was on the Wildin' Out cast, and it was wilding out for him. He got kicked off a few times. So, and I didn't even realize what was going on when I asked the questions I did, but and I'll put that part back in here too, where he just said that basically he, what make you think that I get some kind of information from that nigga? And I'm like, but y'all on the same show together, nigga. Yeah, stuff like that. So it's always some ins and outs of different people, right? But for that kid,
it's a job. You know, it's like you come
in. It's a job in Country Wayne.
Huh?
It's a job.
No, I was saying to what you say about, like, I don't be knowing, like, you know, for Nick and that Wildin' Out experience, it's like, yeah, he kind of, you know, he works and with the cast members. It's not like
Have you been on Wildin' Out like that? Mm-hmm. That's why you tripping, too? You be hanging out with him over there on that camp?
No.
Okay, I'm just trying to figure out what's going on.
I didn't want to season, and then I didn't want as like a writer consultant on it and stuff. But
he take care of you. Did you get your money and everything?
Yeah, they
I'm gonna make sure you got your bread.
Yeah, it's a nice little well. It could definitely be hectic over there. But
oh,
it's cool.
Wait a minute! Whoa! When you say hectic, what do you mean? Because it's something you got to dive into. Because that everybody from the outside looking in enjoy the show. Right. We don't know about the hectic. We see everybody happy, laughing, having a great time.
Yeah,
everybody making jokey jokes. What's the hectic part?
It's just because it's like, you know, they have a large cast of people, and then it's like you're waiting to see what episodes you'll be on or what episodes you're not on, so people don't know if they're on episodes or not. And then, you know, you film, but you don't know if your stuff is going to air on the episode or if they're going to cut it. And, you know, a lot of times it can mess with people, and it's like it's a lot of energy, and it's a lot of people fighting for, you know, one position.
Damn.
And it's not like, you know, if you was on an NFL team, it's like, oh, you got the first string, you got the second string, but you know that's your spot. You know you're the starting quarterback. It's not really like that. Like, it's like a few people who kind of have a spot to do it, like, every episode, but everything else is like, am I on the first string today? Am I on the second string? Am I not on the team at all today? Like, what's going on? You know, and I don't like cattle calls like that. I don't like a whole bunch of things. Like, nah, that's why I'd rather just work on my own stuff.
Well, you definitely got, you got great vibes only. You doing your thing.
Thank you.
You know, you got your own stuff. You cute. You know, you got a lot going for
that,
you.
Because you was going in on people. They'd be like, how dare this ugly bitch stick anybody looking at her?
Okay. All right. Well, I guess I can't run nothing again in that situation. You know, I just do my thing right here and just go on and end it then, huh? No. We're going to turn up again since you said that. No. No, thank you for coming on the show.
Yeah, no problem.
Cynthia, man, would you ever, I mean, because it's hard dealing with me. Mm-hmm. I might go here, there, boom, bop. I don't care.
Right, yeah.
Now, she's real structured. I don't give a damn. You know what I'm saying?
It's so, too valid.
No, yeah. But I definitely enjoyed you, man. When is the next show? Because did I miss that? Did we even ask you about the next show when it's coming up?
I mean, because we don't know when it's going to air.
Right. Oh, okay.
Right. I would say just follow me on Instagram, Cynthia Luciette. I always post when I have shows and stuff like that.
Dope. Live.
Yeah.
Man, thank you so much for coming on the show. We love
thank
you.
Thank y'all for having me.
We appreciate
yeah.
you. You took
shout
the time
to
out. Yeah, shout out to Dallas. Y'all see Cynthia, man. Y'all get in her inbox. She going to hire a lot of people, right?
Yep.
Yeah, she's starting a big production thing like Tyler Perry. I was in the interview when I heard it. So we looking for a call out. She don't go in her inbox and
right.
Yeah.
Right, for real. It's a good time stamp.
And she just going to basically try to get you guys locked in, man. If you're into acting, all that good stuff. Comedian, she would need some undercards, right? You need all that popping.
You do, for sure.
Let's go, man. Check it, man. It's been another great segment of Boss Talk.
We have a whole bunch of people hit me up.
What a Boss's Talk, man.